I first started going to prison on a regular basis about a dozen years ago because I was invited to come by the people who lived there. I was getting letters, I was doing a lot of writing in some of the publications mentioned around issues related to race and criminal justice and pop culture, and I started getting a lot of letters from people inside inviting me to speak. And that ultimately led to my getting, I would say, obsessed with the prison system from the first time that I went in. It was something that didn't make a whole lot of sense to me. I was befuddled by it. I was befuddled by the waste of resources of the incredible men that I was teaching. And it also led to my starting the Prison to College Pipeline program at John Jay College of Criminal Justice, where I teach. And so this all started about a dozen years ago. And at that time, when I would tell people that I taught in prisons or I worked in, or I volunteered in an educational capacity in the prison system, people would look at me as if I was mad and say, why are you doing that? Why are you teaching those people in that place? And I'd have to come up with a litany of answers as to why I did that. And I noticed maybe about 3-4 years ago that those questions kind of stopped coming, that quite often people weren't asking me as much, why are you doing this? Because there started to be a national understanding of the fact that prisons and mass incarceration is in many ways the civil rights issue of our time. And there started to be a lot of national conversation and best-selling books around the issue, and more folks were talking about it, and there was all of a sudden, you know, we were hearing bipartisan support, Republicans were coming out against mass incarceration. And all that was heartening, but what I noticed was that there were some things that were missing from the conversation. One of them was that there was a lot of conversation around mass incarceration in the U.S. and our crisis here with 2.3 million people incarcerated, but there wasn't much conversation about this on a global scale and how American policies are impacting the world and the role of prisons on foreign shores. And the other thing that I noticed is that there was a lot of conversation around ending mass incarceration from a very sort of pragmatic standpoint, and especially an economic one. And there was a lot of talk about how much money we're wasting on prisons, and certainly the bipartisan support came from this idea that we're wasting so much money and we could do this a lot more effectively, and we should let out the, quote, nonviolent offenders and drug offenders and so on. But there wasn't a whole lot of talk from a moral standpoint. And given those two things, and given my interest in the world and my love of travel, I thought to myself, well, I should go check out some prison systems around the world. And in doing that, not only shed light on what's happening in a global context, but also have a minute to sort of step back and think about some of these fundamental issues, the fundamental kind of social and moral issues at stake when we talk about prisons, and not just think pragmatics and economics. And that is what led to Incarceration Nations and this journey that took about 3 years to visit different prison systems, spend time in different prison systems, talk with incarcerated people around the world. And so what I wanted to do tonight is kind of take you through the journey a little bit and then have time to have dialogue with you and take questions and talk about some of the kind of ultimate lessons learned. And We start in Rwanda, which is the slide. I've got one slide from each. I've got more photos than that, but I selected one slide from each country. And we start in Rwanda, which is where I started my journey. And I went to Rwanda first because surely when I say Rwanda, the first thing that you think about is genocide. And that nation is pretty much defined by the genocide at this point that happened 20 years ago. But what I had heard about was Rwanda's rather unique approach in dealing with the genocide, something called Gacaca courts that were alternatives to mass incarceration that involved reconciliation and restitution plans on a grand scale, and a very glaring example of that. And so I went to Rwanda to learn more about that, and also because fundamentally I come from, and I'll talk more about this, but I always come from a restorative justice bent. And in a restorative justice framework, the most important thing that you need to start any conversation about crime discussing is the victim. You don't start by talking about who did it, but you talk about who was harmed, who was impacted. And Rwanda is, in many ways, a nation of victims. It's a nation of victims and a nation of offenders. And so I wanted to look at these people harmed by this atrocity of our time and think about how can we grapple with that and how did we deal with that? How does the justice system deal with that? So I went to Rwanda and had the opportunity, and in general, my game plan with the journey was to try to do as much doing as I could, and not so much standing with a notebook and scribbling, but rather being engaged and involved whenever possible, working with NGOs whenever possible, to be involved in the worlds that I was kind of trespassing on. So I went to Rwanda and I worked with an organization called Never Again Rwanda. And they're specifically designed for young genocide survivors who are between 20 and 25. So they're young enough such that the genocide, in many ways, they don't remember it, but they're old enough to have been deeply impacted by it. Most of them were orphaned by the genocide. And I connected with the organization. I was struck by the name, Never Again Rwanda. I grew up in a family in the shadow of the Holocaust, so the name, the phrase Never Again was one that was something I heard again and again growing up. And there, I was told that they had already, there was this group of young people who wanted to visit prisons. And it wasn't clear to me exactly what they wanted to do, but they wanted to go to these prisons where something like 80% of the people inside are in for the crime of genocide. And so I went to Rwanda, and I worked with these young people to develop a program where they would go into the prisons and visit as a show of solidarity, as a show of peace, as a show of reconciliation. And they didn't want to go in and talk about the genocide and who did what. They wanted to go in and engage and talk politics and screen films and play soccer and engage, have dance classes, activities that showed the sort of common human bond. And they were, these young people were incredibly excited about this, the possibility of doing this. And so I had the opportunity to work with them and develop this program such that they were able to go inside and start this program, which is still in effect now in Rwanda. So they visit these prisons. Now the slide up here is a photo, it's just an offhanded snapshot of the Rwandan prison. The men in, I went to one prison with them. I spent most of the time there sort of developing the program, understanding, meeting with victims, and understanding how they came to grips with what they went through. But this was the day of our visit. The ones in orange have been sentenced, and the ones in pink are on remand, so they haven't been sentenced yet. And the day that they launched this program was one of the most exhilarating days that I've ever witnessed, because it was, for these young people, they came out of there feeling just unbelievably inspired, moved, I want to say even healed by the experience of having gone in and engaged in a common humanity with people who potentially could have killed their parents. And the lesson in all of that, and that's sort of the program that came out of my experience in Rwanda, but I also had the chance to go to peace villages and speak to many people about their how they worked through the genocide and how they were impacted by the Gacaca courts. But the lesson in all of that for me is that ultimately we sell humanity very short, and we think we know what victims want all the time, which is vengeance, and we think that that is deserved, and that is a synonym for justice, and vengeance or punishment, if we want to call it by a prettier term, is a synonym for justice. But in fact, what I saw here is that there is another way, there is another path, and that these were victims who were finding their sense of justice in a way that's radically different from the punishment-centered approach. And so I continued thinking about these issues and really these philosophical issues. In many ways, the book is more a work of philosophy than anything else, because it's thinking through some of the fundamental issues at stake when we think about prisons and talk about prisons. And I wanted to continue this theme of what is reconciliation, what is restitution, what do victims need and want, what brings victims true senses of justice, and what is this entity that we talk about and throw around a lot called forgiveness. So I went to another country that's sort of defined by a process of reconciliation on a national level, and that's South Africa, home of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. This is Polesmoor Prison in South Africa. Polesmoor is arguably the largest prison in Africa. It's got about 8,000 people in it, men, women, juveniles. And actually, Mandela spent 6 years in there. It's quite a notorious prison. It's a home to one of the most notorious prison gangs in the world called the Numbers. And it's enormously overcrowded. It's at about 180% capacity. So there are something like 40, 45 people in a small, in a cell that's about half the size of this stage. But what I went in there to do was be part of a, continuing this theme of restorative justice and this theme of forgiveness, was be part of a very famous restorative justice workshop that's sort of the last restorative justice workshop in town in South Africa due to budget cuts in the prison system in the Department of Corrections there. And this is, it was actually a Christian-run restorative justice workshop, and I had the opportunity to be a facilitator there. And as part of that, I worked with men coming to grips with what they had done, and it was about, really all about sort of thinking, number one, about what forgiveness looks like on a one-to-one basis, as opposed to thinking about it on a national level, as I did much more in Rwanda, but thinking about what, if we're gonna put sort of restitution, reconciliation, all the big R words at the center of a justice system, what does it look like on a one-to-one level? And what happened over the course of the 8-9 days of this very intense all-day restorative justice workshop was that I watched and worked with men who were coming to grips with what they had done, and who were also coming to grips with ways that they'd been victimized by the same system, and victimized by the people that they had harmed, and grappling with this cycle of harm. And it's something we often forget about, which is the reality that the good bulk of people in prison, is particularly true about women in prison, as I'll talk about, we're victims as well. And it's not, it's all part of a cycle of harm and destruction. And so what many of the men were dealing with was the ways that they were harmed, both in terms of their individual lives growing up in townships in South Africa and ghettos in South Africa, but also in terms of the whole structural racism and inequality of apartheid and in the shadow of apartheid. And I'll read to you a bit from the South Africa chapter, which is the moment where at the end of this workshop, these men confronted their family members, many of whom they had directly victimized, either through directly harming them or something along those lines, or either way had indirectly harmed them by virtue of being involved in crime and bringing danger to the house. And so it was a process of reconciliation. And I'll read to you a bit from what happened on that final day, which is one of the most moving and intense days of my life. And I should say by way of background that for this chapter, I spent time staying right across the street from Polesmoor Prison, which happened to be one of the most expensive hotels in South Africa. It's a winery. And that wasn't on my budget. I was doing a travel story. I funded some of the book by doing travel writing, and I was writing about the wine district that this prison happens to be located in. Ironically, this hellhole of a prison, one of the worst prisons, notorious prisons in the world, is located in one of the wealthiest, whitest wine regions in South Africa. So every day, in many ways I did this intentionally because it so deeply reflects the glaring inequality of South Africa and the way that the system is structured, the unbelievable wealth and then the unbelievable poverty. So they would drop me off. It was literally across the street, but the hotel being the hotel would not even let me walk to Polesmoor. So they would drop me off in their chauffeured limousine, which was hugely embarrassing. I'd always try to get them to drop me before the gate. So, the ultimate day of correction finally arrives. It's a moment of reckoning. The men in orange will put their week of soul searching to the test by confronting those most acutely impacted and victimized by their deeds, their families. Anthony greets me with the news that he's been denied parole yet again. I tell him I've recently gotten the same news from America, where a parole board consisting of political appointees has decided that 23 years is not enough punishment for one of my most promising students, who's been in prison since age 18. The victim wants more time from you, they told my student. Do they also want a pound of flesh? I'd angrily wanted to shout at the board. What kind of justice system cultivates such profound levels of vengeance? There isn't much out there. Anthony gestures toward the window, the barbed wire, the Constantia mountain range with a shrug. For someone like me, I probably belong here. I'm old. He shrugs again. Maybe I will die here. Anthony's family members did not make it today, but many others did. Wives, fathers, mothers, grandmothers, grown sons and daughters trickle in and take seats on benches in the middle of the room. It's a reunion scene of awkward handshakes and suspicious once-overs in lieu of warm embraces. Jerome, whose phone call with his mother had taken a toll on him days earlier, looks nervously around the room and strokes his chin, where faint traces of a beard have begun to sprout. Will his mother show up? Welcome, Jonathan booms. Jonathan is the leader, the pastor who leads the workshop. Welcome to your opportunity to restore broken relationships. It is your time. Come forward and make statements. Tell us how you feel, eh? You can say if you want, I am sad, or I am angry, or maybe you want to ask questions. Why? How long is your sentence? This is your chance to have them answered. Everything you wanted to know, not to degrade, but to restore. Come forward. They come, eagerly. First, big sister of Yahya. She faces the gangster who is her brother, who stands with hands on hips, shifting his weight from one leg to another. Yahya has spoken all week of being hated, rejected by his broken family. During public sessions, he has animatedly detailed the feelings of rage that this caused him. I don't know you. We weren't raised together. I never wanted to know you because I thought he's a criminal. She sizes up her brother. He adjusts his shades. But now I say to you, you are loved. Suddenly, the gangster collapses into sobs. He hides his head in his hands and cries uncontrollably as his sister goes on. We will try now to restore that bond. My brother, we will try. They are both sobbing now. Then, at Jonathan's command, they are embracing. The white prisoner hasn't seen his mother in 5 years. Mother, widowed just weeks ago, grips his face with both hands. Look me in the eye, my son, she says. I unconditionally love you. Son falls tearfully into mother's arms. Watching these narratives broaden before my eyes takes my breath away. It happened when I sat with Gershwin and his mother, too. Apology, in the root sense of the word, from the Greek apologos, meaning story. I've been listening to stories all week, confessions about childhoods, criminal acts, family wrongs. But when offender and victim are reunited, these stories are suddenly infused with fresh dimensions, supplied by family members who are critical protagonists in them, too. In Xhosa, in Afrikaans, in English, the prisoners are solicited one by one by the people they love. Tell me the truth. You have made me a failure because I cannot raise my own son. How could you have stolen from your own wife? Resentment is a storytelling passion, writes philosopher Charles Griswold. Restorative justice involves widening and deepening that narrative to include the narrative of the wrongdoer, which does not excuse, but does explain. Two architects of restorative justice, Barb Toes and Howard Zurr, propose that the meaning of a given crime must be actively determined through dialogue, and meaningful justice can only emerge when, quote, co-authored by the victim and the offender. Today's tears thus have a reddish tint. They're a bloodletting. Again and again comes a resounding chorus of those tremendous words, I am sorry. Hardened gangsters collapse, bawling in their mother's arms. Fathers confess love for sons they never really knew. Tattooed faces grow puffy and damp. Shame is rife and hours pass. The line grows longer as family members decide that there's more to say, more to ask. Some extra sensitive confrontations, like the wife facing the husband who raped her, are relocated to be handled privately. But the rest are public acts, a cleansing ritual like nothing I've ever witnessed. Will you buy me that bicycle, Papa, so we can ride together like we used to? Jonathan halts the proceedings. We can spend all day here, he says. I can spend the next lifetime here restoring, but I want everyone to have 1 hour with family just to spend time. Don't talk about the weather. This is your quality time. Continue to connect. Jerome's mother never made it. Jonathan lets me know that when the car arrived to carry her here, she was too much under the influence to take the ride. He slumped at the table, disappointment and emotional exhaustion having annihilated the gangster swagger he once exuded. I sit with Gershwin, who makes a declaration. "Baz, I have decided I will not take parole," he says, nibbling on a meat patty. "I am not ready. I know now that I will react badly. I need more time to work on my anger. I need to work with my family. I will cause trouble if I go home now." I ask him if he's heard of Malcolm X. "Is that a rapper?" he asks. I give him the rundown on the gangster-turned-leader who educated himself behind American bars. "Baz, I will make you a promise," he says. "I will learn to read. I will enroll in the literacy classes. I promise. I feel sorry, Baz, for my family, for my life." All apologies are promises, so-called performative utterances, words that are also actions. Their ultimate meaning thus hinges on the future, which is why the Jewish sage Maimonides defined true repentance as a scenario in which the sinner faces the same temptation to wrongdoing, yet this time resists it. I believe Gershwin's apology and take his promise as sincere. I also believe many of the apologies I've heard all week long. But forgiveness rarely comes in one fell swoop, rather in fits and starts. So only the future will lend all of these words their true dimension. The day concludes with a climactic return. On day one of the program, Jonathan had sent one of the guards to purchase 3 chocolate bars from the shop and presented them to Gershwin, Yahya, and Jerome. Would the 3 men in orange return the much coveted chocolate on the last day? Could they be trusted not to eat or sell this precious commodity? Gershwin stands proudly on his chair, displays his chocolate, and speaks in steady Afrikaans. "I never allowed people to trust me. I came to realize how many people I hurt in the past. This, it looks like a simple chocolate, but the thought behind it has a lot of significance. In English," he said, "I feel, see, convinced about myself." The room erupts into a standing ovation, 3 gangsters standing on chairs and wielding chocolate bars as if they're MVP trophies. PJ, the facilitator and former Polsmore prisoner, closes out the day with a hip-hop performance in Afrikaans. He then shares in stolid tones his story of abuse and murder, prison and religion and redemption. Jonathan embraces him and turns to the families. "I want you to look at him," he says, "and see your son. This is a good man, and this is your son." That afternoon, Wilbert, the hotel driver, takes me home from Polsmore in the limo. "You will not go to Polsmore tomorrow, ma'am," he asks. "No, today was the last day." "Ma'am, I hope you don't mind to say that I have enjoyed taking you there every morning." "Thank you, Wilbert." "Ma'am, yes, it was inspiring to see you come in and out safely every day." "See, ma'am," he pauses and lets out a slight cough, "it is only this close that I did not end up there myself." He holds 2 fingers up from the wheel. "The judge said he would give me a second chance. And ma'am, I have done well. It is 2 months I am on this job, no more crime, I am a new man." And just like that, 2 universes collided. So, thank you. From there I went to Uganda, right nearby. And I went to Uganda, I actually paired it in the book with Jamaica, because I wanted to look specifically at, when we throw this term around rehabilitation, it is called a Department of Corrections, after all, right? So we like to pay lip service to this idea of rehabilitation. And one of the things that we talk about the most is the arts. And we talk about the role that the arts can play in a prison to improve people's senses of self, to act as a form of therapy, and so on. And so I wanted to look closely at 2 forms of the arts and how they impacted people in a prison context. So I went to Uganda. I worked with an organization called the African Prison Projects, and I ended up launching a creative writing program in a Ugandan prison that was, again, notoriously overcrowded. This one is at 235% capacity. People are sleeping standing up, literally. And it's an old colonial prison that was built in the 1930s. And I ended up working with these were some of the students that I worked with here. This one, the one all the way on the right, his name is Wilson. He was the sort of star student. If you can see on his shirt, it says Pastor Boma. And that's because he decided he was a pastor in prison, and Boma is the name of his cell block, and he became the sort of leader of that cell block. So he was also the leader in many ways of the workshop. The idea behind the creative writing workshop was to start it and then have the men take over after I left. And so I was really working with the kind of leaders in the prison who would then be able to carry on and take it from there. And similarly, in Jamaica, where I spent a shorter time, I visited a music studio. Some of you might have seen the group in Malawi that was nominated for a Grammy the other night. Well, I visited a very similar music program that's going on in Jamaica, where they're making reggae music behind bars in, again, a hideously overcrowded prison in Kingston, Jamaica, called General Penitentiary, or GP. And in both of these spaces, it was an opportunity to look at, well, yes, the power of what the arts can do in terms of promoting psychological healing, in terms of promoting, frankly, sanity in an environment that would drive any one of us sitting here mad because of the level of overcrowding. To give you a sense of how awful it is in the Jamaican prison, people are only, the prisoners are only out of their cells for about 2 to 3 hours a day. The rest of the time they're in cells with other people who it's very strictly gang controlled. There's no toilets, there's in the cell. If you have to go to the bathroom, you find somewhere to go. If you have to defecate, you have to wait and hold it in, unless the person who runs your cell actually gives you permission, and people are getting sick left, right, and center because of that. I mean, that's how horrific the conditions are. And it's a chance to think about, certainly, I mean, I'm an English professor. No one loves the arts more than I do. No one believes in the power of the arts. But it was also a way to think about sort of the troubling ways that the arts can sometimes be a Band-Aid in circumstances where massive overhaul needs to happen. And that the arts in their kind of pretty glory can block us to some of the larger issues at stake, this is quite true, I think, in America as well. So I left both of those places in a sort of conundrum around these kinds of programs. That's Jamaica. That's General Penitentiary. And also, if you notice, I'll say more about this at the end, but you know, if you look at this prison, you could think it's right here, right in America. It looks like an American prison. It's not an accident. These prisons, Luzira in Uganda, Jamaica, many other prisons, were directly modeled after American prisons. And in fact, the head of corrections in Jamaica went to the U.S. to build this, in order to create a model directly after the U.S. prison. So that's General Penitentiary. So this is Thailand. And these are incarcerated women, and that's obviously a corrections officer and another corrections officer there. They're doing origami in this picture. I went to Thailand specifically to look at the plight of incarcerated women. Women are, globally speaking, the fastest growing segment of the prison population. They certainly are in America. It's a skyrocketing population in America. Almost 80% of women in American prisons are not in for violent offenses. And that's certainly true in Thailand. I went to Thailand because one of the princesses of Thailand, who's quite a superstar there, is her pet project is prisons, and her passion is prison reform, and specifically women in prison, and addressing the unique needs of women in prison. And so she's been pushing she does a lot of government advocacy work, what's known as the Bangkok rules governing, which are UN regulations that they can't really be mandated, but they're recommended ideas about how to treat women in prison, given that they have special needs. But she also has created these model, quote unquote, model prisons, which is a bit of an oxymoronic phrase, but she's trying to reform the system. The other thing to know about Thailand is that there's about 25,000 women in prison, and about 21,000 of them are in for drug-related offenses. And most of them, about 18,000, are in for 20 years or more on drug-related offenses. So it's a very dramatic situation, which is why, and very significantly, more than half have had co-defendants who were men, and something like 45% had co-defendants who were husbands or boyfriends. So the attitude, I mean, clearly you can put two and two together and you see where it leads, which is that these women are they're acting as carriers for much larger operations that are run by men. And so they're sort of hapless victims of a much larger system and a drug war that is going after all the wrong people. So, which is, again, not unlike what's happening in our country in many respects, in terms of women and in terms of small-time offenders and what we're doing there. So what the princess has done, I had the chance to visit several of her quote-unquote model prisons, and this is the crown jewel of them. It's called Ratchaburi in South Thailand. And and I led a drama workshop. I worked with a colleague at Jeonjae to run a drama workshop in the prison with the women using a translator. And it was obviously a profound experience. It was both enormously depressing. The plight of these women is horrific. But at the same time, it was also heartening to see what the princess was trying to build. And she had nurseries in there. There were yoga classes. We were leading drama workshops. You're seeing here origami. There was painting and art, computer classes, massages, all kinds of programs going on. And it's sort of this pocket of progress in a place where you might least expect it. And at the end of that trip, I actually then had the opportunity to go back to Thailand and meet the princess herself. And it became a meditation for me on the power of public relations when it comes to prisons. She staged an enormous press event inside the prison, inside this prison, Ratchaburi. She had me come back and speak. She had various others. There was a professor from Australia, a yogi from India, and all of us came to talk, and it was the big news. The princess is in the prison, and it was all over the news and the newspapers, and it was quite a dramatic event. I had to learn how to curtsy properly in order to meet her. It was probably the most surreal day of my entire life. But and I had many questions about it, and I talk about those questions in the book. But ultimately, it was pretty amazing in that it got people to look and it made people pay attention, at least for the time being. So that was a fascinating experience from Thailand. That's about as close as we can get in a photo to the federal supermax prison, the first federal supermax prison in Brazil. And Brazil is a place where it's actually most notorious for prisons that are nothing like this prison. It's notorious for overcrowded prisons, again, gangs, very similar to South Africa. There's a lot of parallels between the two. But what was also what I'd heard about happening in Brazil was that there was a growth of the federal supermax system in Brazil, and they were building these enormously expensive solitary confinement units. And so what I went to do in Brazil was think about solitary confinement as a practice, and specifically in these federal supermaxes. And supermaxes are an American invention. We came up with the notion of a supermax, and supermaxes, in a nutshell, a supermax means it relies heavily on solitary confinement. It relies heavily on a controlled environment. There's very limited movement, and most of the time people are in solitary for 23 hours a day. That's what the case was in Brazil. And this is probably the darkest chapter in the book and one of the darkest experiences that I've confronted ever, which is the experience of solitary confinement and people going flagrantly mad from being isolated for years for 23 hours a day, having 1 hour a day to be free. And it's a terrifying thing. It's been in the news quite a bit, thankfully. President Obama recently abolished solitary for juveniles in federal prisons. Unfortunately, that impacts about 20 people in the world. That's how many juveniles there are in solitary in federal. But as a gesture, it's wonderful. But if anything, I would say that after my experience in Brazil, solitary is cruel and unusual punishment, whether you're 15 years old or 50 years old. And to witness that process, and then to learn some more about the history behind it and the political background behind it, that it's being used as a political tool. Supermaxes in general are proliferating around the world. There are 12 countries that are utilizing this American model that we created. And this is an absolutely terrifying example of it. I'll read briefly from the Brazil chapter to give you a sense of what the Brazilian prison was like. The next morning when we arrive, spots of fluorescent color in the form of women visitors animate the drab barbed wire. Dress code rules ban almost every hue except yellow and pink, because Big Brother in Brasilia must easily differentiate on camera between prisoners, staff, and visitors. The result is bizarrely cinematic. All of these women have come from worlds away. Some have had their travel paid for by the PCC. That's the most notorious gang in Brazil, because their husbands are prominent gang members. Many have slept outside the gates in hopes of being first in line, and all are about to endure marathons of waiting, security procedures, and body cavity checks, only to land a few hours with loved ones. But here they are, swathed in the most cheery, exuberant tints imaginable. As we pass them and go through security, we are handed shots of cafezinho. Discarded plastic cups leave a trail through the prison. With agents working overnight shifts, this strong black sweet stuff is the oil that keeps the machine running. Today is cold and rainy. Snaking through dark concrete hallways, the chill seeps into my bones. As we turn a corner, narrow rays of light illuminate a massive field behind bars with a barbed wire skylight. Cohorts of 13 prisoners are granted 2 hours a day in this sunbed, which I'd spied earlier, and during this time they are forbidden to speak to more than three men at any given time. The soccer ball slams against the wall. Bodies tear through the space with ferocious alacrity, leaping and kicking and calling to each other. Bodies gasp for air, bare-chested, barefoot bodies smile, laugh, leap, and live. Then, pare, silence. The soccer ball rolls to a slow halt. Prisoners freeze, line up against the wall and bow their heads. Smiles dissolve. Numero un, calls the agent. The richly choreographed perp walk begins. One by one, head hanging down, march to the agent. About face, kneel, present hands to be cuffed through the bars. Spin around and approach the next agent. About face again as the door opens and slams shut, and the body is once more interred in a cell for 22 hours. Numero dos, calls the agent. The ritual repeats until all that remains in the sunbed is a half-deflated soccer ball. Agents walk the perimeter with plastic gloves, checking for objects left behind. Then, minutes later, the door opens and 13 men march silently, single file with head bowed. They stand facing the wall and are uncuffed one by one. Liberal, calls the agent. You are free. Instantly, there are hugs and embraces, laughter and smiles, heads held high. They talk with each other with the guards. Haircuts are given with an electric razor plugged in near the bars. Puffs of hair sail to the ground. The soccer ball soars skyward. The whole thing is a death and resurrection rite of the most profound order. I spy Carlos looking even more boyish now than more than his eyes are visible. Interno, says his t-shirt, but I misread it as inferno. Come, let me show you their cells, our agent says. Are you sure that's okay, I ask, hesitating to trespass on private spaces. Of course, this prison is ours, not theirs, the agent insists proudly, guiding us inside Cella Ola on cell block Charlie. A worn copy of Dear John by Nicholas Sparks rests on the urine-yellow concrete shelf near a shower that automatically sprays water at the same hour every day. Four faded photographs of children are tacked above the bed. On the desk is a pen removed from its plastic casing beside stenciled drawings of Dalmatians, praying hands, and birds in cages. Layers of gentle pink light stream through lofty cathedral windows, the muffled echoes of metal doors creaking open and the muted voices crying to each other from cell blocks far away reach us like calls to prayer. For the first time, I viscerally grasp the word penitentiary from penitence. This place has the feel of an eerie, haunted monastery. It's as if I'm in a chilling cross between a church and a concentration camp. Cells have no mirrors, the agent explains. In fact, one news crew filming here left a camera outside the slat of a cell overnight and returned to find the man who lives in the cell staring at the camera lens, enchanted by his own reflection. Neat and clean and efficient, this cell, says the agent, as if he had built it himself. Nothing like the state prison. Clean, safe. Indeed, Catanduvas is worlds away from Brazil's state prisons, which is clearly why I'm here. The government is eager to show off its pristine, pricey investment. In 2014, the year a video surfaced showing Brazilian prisoners beheading three fellow prisoners, a UN human rights body expressed concern over the dire state of Brazil's savagely overcrowded, violent prisons where more than 80% of incarcerated people cannot afford a lawyer. Many states do not provide separate facilities for women, and male officers in women's prisons are known to extort sexual favors. Adolescents can be jailed with adults in units without bathrooms. In 2009, 16,466 people were found to be imprisoned irregularly. Many had spent far longer in pretrial detention than they would have served as sentenced prisoners. In one case, a man spent 11 years on remand. In the state of Espírito Santo, amid accusations of torture and abuse between 2009 and 2011, the government barred entry to prison cells, even to the officially mandated body monitoring the system. It's mealtime. Through another hallway, more metal carts are steered by agents wearing wraparound shades. The ritual begins. One by one, drinks are poured into plastic cups, metal trays are inserted through door slats into eager hands, and then the slats are slammed shut. Visiting women in pink pass us on their way out, their cheeks puffy and damp. I make out the cries of a baby. "So sad," Mara says, rubbing her eyes. He is visiting family, saying, "Daddy." So that was Brazil. This is Australia. And that is actually not a prison anymore, but a museum. It's Fremantle Prison in Western Australia. And of course, Australia was founded, like many countries, as a penal colony. And so its legacy of incarceration runs deep. I went there specifically to think about the role of private prisons and to grapple with the issue of privatization when it comes to the prison system. Australia holds the largest number of people in private prisons of any country in the world. So it's heavily, again, privatization is an American invention in corrections that has been exported, and Australia is very heavily into copycatting the American system in all kinds of ways, particularly in corrections. So in Australia, I visited several different private prisons, and I came in there with a bias, which probably if you're at all liberal, you share with me, which is that private prisons are evil. They're about keeping beds filled. They are about making money off incarceration. And what the experience that I had visiting these prisons, and actually I ended up teaching an autobiography writing course in one of them, was that this picture is actually much more complex than that. And prisons as they stand today are indeed evil, and that is because we allow them frightening amounts of lobbying power in our government. And so we have these billion-dollar corrections companies, private prison companies, controlling sentencing laws, essentially, and therefore keeping beds filled. And as we allow them to run, it's a hideous, awful atrocity. But what I found in Australia is that doesn't necessarily have to be the case. Now, there are many problems with the private prison system in Australia, many of them, and I talk about them and I witness them. But there are also some ways in which the private system has allowed people to innovate in ways that the public system, with its bureaucracy and red tape, hasn't. And so one of the prisons that I went to was called Wandu. It was a prison for 18 to 21-year-old young men who are thus legally old enough to be prosecuted as adults, but young enough to be particularly vulnerable to the system. So Wandu is an incredible space that's much more like a campus. It's run on restorative justice principles, and it's run like a campus. The men go and come. They work in the community. They do restoration via community service work. And it was an incredibly inspiring, stunning place that moved me, particularly because I have many students in the prison to college pipeline who went to prison at that age, were deeply impacted by the system, and could have benefited from a place like this had such a thing existed in our country. And the other place I went to, Acacia, these are all in Western Australia, was a far more traditional prison, but at the same time I worked closely with the educational supervisor there who was innovating left, right, and center, who allowed me to teach a course with no permissions getting whatsoever, to bring Malcolm X into the prison, to, with no curriculum check, absolute openness, and who is still in very close touch with me about the work he's doing in that prison to transform it into a space, restorative justice, Aboriginal healing circles, all kinds of things that made me think about the ways that privatization is the devil and isn't the devil, and what could happen in many ways if we thought innovatively, really, above all. And I think the other thing that's interesting about Australia is that it is, as I said, it was a penal colony, so it's got this legacy of everyone coming from a background of having a criminal record, which used to be this shameful thing, and no one wanted to find someone in their line, their family tree, who came as a quote-unquote convict. And I put that in quotation marks because you could be shipped off to Australia in the 19th century for stealing a loaf of bread in the street, and I don't know if that qualifies you as a convict, but we classify everyone who got sent there as a convict. And so, and I thought that there's a strange and painful similarity to our country at this point where some 5.6 million people have a criminal record. We're criminalizing people to such a degree that in a sense we're becoming a sort of penal colony. If you're not in prison, you have a record or you've been impacted by the criminal justice system in all kinds of frightening ways. So the last two countries, this is not a prison, but an ad in Singapore. I went to Singapore. It was easily the most controlled of all the visits that I took. The Singaporean government is notorious for being very controlling when it comes to press, when it comes to its systems. It controls the media. But yet they welcomed me to Singapore to take a look at their approaches to reentry. And this is, again, one of those moments where you find progressive pockets in places that you don't associate with progressive thinking. Certainly Singapore is full of progressive thinking, but when it comes to corrections, probably you most associate it with caning, which is, you know, the horrible corporal practice, which is still in effect in Singapore. But what I went to see was a very fascinating approach to what we call prisoner reentry, a term that I hate because it sounds so simple, like, I left the room, now I reenter. But in fact, you know, going to prison and coming home is, I feel like I live it vicariously through my students in the prison to college pipeline who are coming home regularly and grappling with the enormous obstacles that our society puts in their way, left, right, and center. At every turn, there is something blocking you, whether it's for your job, for your housing opportunities, individual cases of discrimination, lack of being, you're not eligible for welfare, social services. I mean, reentry makes it sound nice and simple, and it's anything but. So I was really interested in what Singapore was doing with reentry, and they have something called the Yellow Ribbon Project, where they promote reentry in a very profound way. They have an ad campaign, that's what this is. This is one of their ads. They actually, this is how together Singapore is. I expressed admiration for this ad, and the next thing I know, it showed up at my hotel room on government service in the envelope. And it says, to stay out of prison, all he needs is a break. So It's one of the incredible, they have a TV spot as well. I can show some of you later during the chit-chat period. I have it on my computer. They promote acceptance of formerly incarcerated people and culture. The yellow ribbon idea comes from the song, Tie a Yellow Ribbon Around the Old Oak Tree, which is about veterans. And they create a parallel between veterans coming home from war and people coming home from prison. And they also have this unbelievable job bank that allows, something like 97% of all people coming home from prison are guaranteed a job, and they stay in that job. The chapter actually closes with going to a lunch in the prison. They have dining behind bars, which is a pretty, it was a brunch behind bars. I was sitting at the table with all these CEOs who support hiring, and they all hire formerly incarcerated people. Of course, it's never as simple, you know, things are far more complex than they look, and so I think about the ways that this, you know, what the ulterior motives are here, but overall, the ad campaign in particular is something that stunned me as something we could think about in this country where we've turned reentry into a horrific obstacle course. The last place I went, doesn't look like prison, right? That's Norway. That's the prison in Norway. Very famous prison called Bastoy. I went to Norway because Norway is Norway, and it is everyone's, when people imagine a utopia in many respects, but particularly a criminal justice utopia, they think of Norway. That's why Michael Moore filmed there for Sicko. He filmed at Bastoy. And I had the opportunity to visit two prisons in Norway, one of them Bastoy, it's a prison island, and I'll read to you a bit from it and wrap up with that in Norway. And then the other one, the other prison that I visited there was a closed prison, but it's jokingly called the IKEA prison. It's beautiful, it has a music studio, it has this, it has that. But what struck me about, now granted, and Norway has been talked about actually a lot lately. There was an editorial in the New York Times recently about the Norwegian system and the Norwegian approach. And uh, it there are many things, you know, each country is unique, and I hesitate to say, oh, we should do this because this country does that. We are all unique countries with our own problems, and Norway certainly has a very homogenous population. There's all kinds of reasons why it has a lot of money. there are all kinds of reasons why Norway is as it is. But what's incredible about Norway that I found there, and again, there are no utopias, but there is an unbelievable communitarian spirit that sort of trumps the capitalist ethos that is present in so many aspects of life in Norway, and particularly in the criminal justice system. So I'll read you a little bit from briefly from the Norway chapter, and then I'll just wrap up with a couple words on kind of takeaways. Prison, I asked the two deckhands after the train has carried me to the ferry and now I've boarded a small vessel, hopefully bound for Bastoy Island. Yes, says one of the men, rubbing his hands together for warmth. He looks me up and down with arrogant blue eyes. But sorry, it is only for men. Then he laughs. Come, come, you're in the right place. I look up at the masthead and notice that it's crowned by a dead stuffed swan. We found it frozen in a block of ice years ago, says the other deckhand. He wears a black ski hat and has a wise and kindly face. It's creepy looking, I say. You think so? Our mascot. You're afraid of criminals? He suddenly asks. And before I can answer, we are criminals. I look into his eyes. They're laughing. Is he kidding? Really, we are. Criminals. Are you afraid? Why would I be? I shrug. I'm still not sure if he's joking. I am Wigo, he says, offering a handshake. He's indeed a prisoner, serving a 21-year sentence, the maximum in Norway. But he'll likely be out next year. Cato, the other deckhand, is serving 1.5 years for intention to commit a criminal act, though he insists he's innocent. He and Wigo bring me to a vestibule to show me their daily schedule posted on the wall. We work the 6 to noon shift, Cato says. Then we go back to the prison and relax. Some exercise, then relax in my room. Come, you want to meet the captain? He's not a prisoner, the only one who isn't on this boat. Upstairs, the sturdy captain shakes my hand. You talking to those criminals, he says with a laugh. I'm lapping up this playful mockery of the scary criminals mentality. There's clearly nothing to be afraid of here, and everyone seems to know it. As the boat sets sail, I spy Bastoy, a cluster of gangly pine trees in a gray sea stretching toward a gray sky. Inside the boat's small seating area, Cato sits down next to me and turns on the TV, flipping to the History Channel. Are you on Facebook, he asks. You're allowed Facebook and internet, I counter. Not while over there, he points to the pine trees. But yes, when we are on home leave. I jot down my name on a slip of paper. For the first time since my arrival, a thin line of blue sky appears overhead. They say it is summer camp, Bastoy, says Wigo, as I leave the cabin to disembark. He's almost reprimanding me. You will maybe think so, but no, it is prison. Trust me, we have our lives stopped, frozen. I point to the swan, like your mascot, frozen, even on a beautiful island. Wigo nods emphatically. Back to the mainland, he calls to Cato, ready for another run. Modern-day Charons, I think, ferrying new souls across the river to the underworld. It hardly looks like the underworld, though. Wigo was right. It does look like summer camp. Or this time of year, a calendar painting for October. Mottled leaves are falling on cyclers. Yes, they're prisoners. And a horse and carriage canters by. Gingerbread houses dot the landscape. They're dull yellow with green trim and red roofs. I spy sheep and cows, but no fence or barbed wire. Bastoy, after all, is an open prison, a concept born in Finland during the 1930s and now part of the norm throughout Scandinavia, where prisoners can sometimes keep their jobs on the outside while serving time, commuting daily. 30% of Norway's prisons are open, and Bastoy, a notorious reformatory for boys, converted in 1984 to a prison, is considered the crown jewel of them all. A small yellow van driven by a smiling officer carries me to a cabin where I check my phone in, the first thing that remotely suggests prison. Tom, the governor, not a warden or superintendent, but a governor, looks like Kevin Costner. He offers me a cup of coffee and we take a seat in his office, which, with its floral drapes, aloe plants, and faintly perfumed cinder scent, reminds me of a quaint bed and breakfast somewhere in New England. It doesn't work. We only do it because we're lazy, Tom says flatly. He's talking about the traditional prison system, where he was stationed for 22 years before running this open prison. A fly buzzes loudly by the window as Tom goes on. I started skeptical. That changed quickly. More prisons should be open. Almost all should be. We take as many as we can here, but there isn't room for everyone. Prisoners from around the country can apply to move to an open prison like Bastoy when they're within 3 years of release. The island is home to 115 men overseen by 73 staff members, but there's a wait list of about 30. There's a perception that, oh, this is the lightweight prison. You just take the nice guys for the summer camp prison. But in fact, no. Our guys are into, pardon my French, some heavy shit, drugs and violence. And the truth is, some have been problematic in other prisons, but then they come here and we find them easy. We say, is that the same guy you call difficult? It's really very simple. Treat people like dirt and they will be dirt. Treat them like human beings and they will act like human beings. He opens the window to let the fly go free. Come, let's take a stroll. We wander through the forest, past grazing horses, a breeding area for birds, a greenhouse, and a barbecue pit where men can cook lunch. Prisoners live in shared houses resembling log cabins. The delicious smell of burning firewood wafts through the air, and South Africa's Robben Island springs to mind. Bastoy is the opposite of its doppelganger, not its dark, evil twin, but the humane addition of that prison island hellhole. It's not about running a prison, but running an island, Tom explains. This is a nature reserve growing about 25% of its food. Most vehicles are electric and everything is recycled. Agriculture is a big part of our philosophy. We're humane, ecological. Animals have a social function too, teaching empathy. Everyone works the land. Do you live on the island, I ask? I commute by boat every day. I love this. No more driving in traffic to Oslo. He shakes his head. I knew nothing about any of this, you know. I was a city boy. Now my life is so much restored by this place, this lifestyle, just like for the prisoners. Tom shows me a wooden church ornamented by a brass chandelier. Norway is secular, so this is more of a cultural space. The chaplain is more of a therapist than an old-fashioned minister, he explains. He also takes me to a gleaming supermarket, which sells premium cacao, chocolate, and aloe vera juice. There are red phone booths for unlimited use, although Tom thinks cell phones and internet should be permitted in all prisons. What are we afraid of? You can't kill anyone by internet or by phone, he mutters. I ask about stigma and reentry. In Norway, when you're released, he replies. No big stigma. One guy I know spent 18 years in prison and is now living in my neighborhood. A normal old guy, no one cares. You find this a lot. I have many friends who've been to prison. Norwegians are very forgiving people. He pauses. Strange, because we weren't always like that. That's an understatement. This is the land of the pillaging Vikings and of the Nordic sagas, depicted on wooden friezes outside Oslo's City Hall, which I visited the other day. The sagas are long tales of violence, murder, jealousy, and revenge, and it's fascinating to think that somewhere deep in Norway's past, a social tide turned, and as in Rwanda, a culture of peace and forgiveness came to triumph. Over lunch, Tom continues to impress me with his progressive thinking. He explains that although the, quote, conservative party here would be considered liberal anywhere else, and in general, the left and the right agree on the main threads of correctional policy, an influx of immigrants, rising xenophobia, and conservative politics lately threatened to undermine the country's progressive system and soft-on-crime approach. An anti-immigration progress party, part of the conservative-led government, is promoting a backlash against what's known as NAVing, or living off welfare. NAVE is the Norwegian Labor and Welfare Administration. In recent years, a local newspaper claimed that 80% of Norwegians want stricter punishment now, and a 2010 survey showed that a majority felt punishments were too lenient. It's your media that's also responsible, Tom says, biting into a slice of whole grain toast with brown cheese. American TV shows about tough prisons and talk about being tough on crime. It influences people here. But thankfully, that started to change. All the bad press in the past few years from you guys has started to make us not take you all so seriously anymore. Especially in elections, in the political speeches, those biblical references by a secular country, and Sarah Palin. People are laughing and also crying. This is a country we want to imitate? I sigh. It's disturbing the way media can make and unmake the problem. I say as much, adding that the culture of fear is to blame. I tell him a little bit about my Australian experience and the Murdoch media. Yes, Tom concurs, talk to people at a party and every, pardon my French, idiot will insist that there's more crime than there is. Statistics say there is nothing to fear. A study of home leave in Germany, I say, found that failure to return rates amount to a mere 1%. Exactly, Tom nods. Here there were instances where prisoners committed crime while on home leave, but so few of them. You can't construct a whole justice system around one or two exceptions. I tell people, we're releasing neighbors every year. Do you want to release them as ticking time bombs? Is that who you want living next to you? Hey, he puts down his toast, have you seen that film about the Attica warden? Apparently, a recently released Finnish documentary depicts a former Attica superintendent's tour of Halden, a new prison I'll be visiting later this week. They make a laughingstock of him, because where their Norwegian official sees rehabilitation and correction, the American sees risk and danger. He even looks at staff playing cards with prisoners, chatting about each other's lives, calling each other by first names, and he's disgusted. That is not safe, he keeps saying. But where are the statistics to show that it's a danger? How can you help the prisoners if you're not sharing about you and your life and your kids? The men here know my kids, my address, everything. Why should I be afraid? After my visit, as I'm waiting for the yellow van to carry me back to the boat and to Oslo, a man with a chipped front tooth stands beside me. You're from America, he asks. You must think this place is crazy, huh? Without letting me answer, he goes on. But if you treat people like shit, they will be shit. Why doesn't America get it? Funny, because Tony Robbins is so smart and he's from America. He's talking about the self-help guru known for infomercials and books like Unleash the Power Within. The man lets out a nervous laugh. What are you doing here, I ask him. His blue parka says engineering, so I assume he must be repairing equipment. Me? I am sitting here. I'm going to see the doctor, because I may have to be transferred to another open prison. I'm developing allergies to horses. Oh, he's in prison here. I had no idea. I find my own cluelessness deeply moving, because it means things are as they should be. He and I are two human beings. Like my meeting with the deckhands Wigo and Cato, our casual, normal interaction contrasts starkly with the many prison interviews I've done over the years. It's a total erasure of boundaries between us and them. Chatting with me like an old friend on the ride back to the mainland, he tells me that he once worked in oil and traveled the world, and although home leaves have kept him close to family and community, when he goes home next year, it won't be so easy to pick up the pieces. I am hopeful, though. In prison, you can choose to see the sky or choose to see the moss on the ground. I look at the sky. I do, too. For a sliver of a beautiful moment, the sun has dramatically emerged from the clouds, and the world, in full-on color, looks wholly new. So I will stop there, and I'm sure in our conversation and in the Q&A, we'll have a chance to get into some of the final lessons learned and kind of sum ups. So,
well, thank you very much, and I just want to say, tell me more, tell me more.
Read the
but
book.
I'd like to go back to your opening comments on Rwanda and the group for the 18, 20-year-olds to go and interact with the prisoners. What, I guess, was motivating them? What was the sort of social impetus for them to come together like that and to actively go and play soccer and engage socially with the prisoners as a way of overcoming their traumas?
So the Gachacha program, which allowed the, which was how Rwanda dealt with the genocide, which were these massive open courts that resulted in people given, they're given certain kind of reparations directions, i.e. you have to work for this person for 10 years to pay off your debt, ways to make amends to your victims. That process didn't get to really impact these young people because they were too young to experience them. And so they were looking for something along those lines. They were looking for healing, really. And they didn't. They felt like there's this open wound and there's this lack of closure in my life in terms of this loss that I experienced in the genocide. And I want to do that, you know, by confronting the people who harmed me in one way or another and find that healing. And from all that I witnessed, that is exactly what they found and continue to find. And there was one particular leader who I worked most closely with. His name was Santos. That was his nickname. And Santos was devoted to this on a level that I've never seen anyone be devoted to, such to the point where I couldn't believe he was even real. He was so committed to enacting reconciliation and promoting peace and seeing Rwanda heal as a country and individually, that was what was motivating them. So it was definitely a window into the needs of victims in ways that is often different from what we imagine the needs of victims to be. And not that I think there's only one mm-hmm. way, you know. And I'll say, too, that, I mean, my vision of a justice system is obviously, I'm sure you can tell, grounded in restorative justice approaches. And for me, anything that, any way of dealing with crime has to involve restorative justice principles in one way or another.
And if I could beg just another question, did the reconciliation movement there come from sort of Western religious traditions that were in the country, or was there the native culture that had their own traditions that inspired the movement?
Great question. It absolutely came from, gachacha was a term that was used in Rwanda prior to colonial involvement, which imposed prisons. So prisons are a Western imposition. Many ethnic cultures in Africa used forms of restorative justice, circles, certainly Aboriginal peoples in Canada, in Australia. It was a native practice in many parts of the world, which is the most, you know, upsetting thing when we think about the imposition of prisons as this Western invention, because there were all kinds of other ways of dealing with crime as a community and community-based approaches. So gachacha was actually a return to what was seen, and it was promoted as such, that it was a return to the original form of Rwandan justice.
Thank you.
Hi, I loved your talk. Are there pockets of progressivism in the United States, in particular any states that you're working with or that you're encouraged by?
There are,
and also, mm-hmm. is it penitentiary or penitentiary?
Penitentiary.
Penitentiary.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So there definitely are pockets of progressive thinking in the U.S., and one of the, I run a program that's a college program, and I think education is some of the most inspiring things. I mentioned Wandoo in Australia, the prison for 18 to 21-year-olds. There's something interesting happening in San Francisco and soon to be in New York called the Reset Foundation, which is creating a similar kind of campus. I'm an optimist, ultimately, despite the horrors of what I've seen. But so I think that there's a lot that's happening right now that's moving in the right direction. I mean, I was on a panel last night with the DA of San Francisco, who was talking about all kinds of alternatives to incarceration programs, restorative justice programs. there's something called Common Justice in New York that's doing incredible work with restorative justice, not just around quote, low-level offenses, but around serious violent offenses. So it's happening all over the place. I think California, New York, interestingly enough, Texas has some things going on in there that are strange bedfellows, right? But there are all kinds of interesting things happening right now. But I'm just, I'm excited about it, but I remain wary because, number one, a lot of the conversation, again, has been economic, and if it's about money, we'll find a cheaper way to imprison people and warehouse people and create labor populations. I mean, one of the themes that I found around the world was this idea of it criminalizing others in order to produce a labor market, and I found that true. We know this is true about the U.S. in terms of, you know, going back to slavery and the Black Codes, but this is also true in Brazil with coffee plantations and the coffee industry. It's true about the diamond industry in South Africa. It's true about the hill people in Thailand. It's always been about producing that. So economic arguments make me nervous given the legacy of capitalism and mass incarceration. And the other thing that makes me nervous is when we're only talking about, quote, nonviolent offenders and, quote, drug offenders. Because we need, if we let out all of the, you know, if we only dealt with drug offenses, we'd still have a massive prison population. We need to talk about sentencing. We need to stop lumping people into categories of violent, nonviolent. We need to think about people and approaches and that are, you know, not the ones that were, and a new paradigm really that isn't the one we're using now.
So in the last excerpt that you read from, you have a line, you say the erasure of boundaries. So I had the opportunity to hear Dean Spade speak to a number of lawyers. I'm not sure if you're familiar with him or his work. So he is an advocate for prison abolition, which I think is a pretty radical notion. It's one that I'm not personally very familiar with, so I wonder if you have any ideas or thoughts about that.
Yeah, so prison, I guess on record I would call myself a prison abolitionist. Hi, my name is Baz and I'm a prison abolitionist. Prison abolition, Angela Davis is the name most associated with that, but and it's abolition in the sense of obviously hearkening back to slavery in a very direct way. But the idea of prison abolition is really just the belief that, and I truly believe this is probably the central argument of the book, prison is a social experiment that has had its time. And it is not a effective, humane, moral, or economically sound way of dealing with crime. Now, that does not mean that there are not people who need to be kept away from society, who are not fit for society, who will cause enormous harm to others, who need to be kept in some sort of an institution. But the way that I envision it, that institution would look so radically different from prison so as to be worthy of a different name. You know, prison abolition is about undermining our knee-jerk reaction that says the response to crime has to be prison. Do the crime, do the time. And that there are other paradigms for thinking about how we might make amends to victims, how we might create safer communities, and so on.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious, from one of your threads, which is about integration back into society and kind of the problems of othering kind of people who serve time in prisons and such, I'm wondering, in your book, do you focus on larger issues of population changes, demography, in terms of housing and community developments? Not community developments in the sense of just pure, like, actual housing projects, but just the trends within those countries and within our own, in terms of their impacts on how the kind of prison problem and the problems that we've identified are shaped by those kind of changes in housing and kind of population trends in terms of community living style situations, urbanization.
And stuff. Are you thinking specifically about people coming home from prison, or?
Well, partly of that, but also just in terms of if there's any look at how housing trends in terms of the way that communities are being shaped in terms of who's choosing to live where, stratification, mm-hmm. other kind of things lends themselves to that kind of othering. I mean, it touched a little bit, you said qualitatively, with the whole Norway experience of like, these are our neighbors and everything else. And I'm just wondering if there was actually any more in-depth examination on your part on that kind of influence and trends in terms of shaping the lens for prisons and folks who have to go
mm-hmm.
through the system.
Mm-hmm. So there's a lot to say on that, but I mean, housing is and stratification and what you're talking about is relevant insofar as we think about economic inequality. And there's numerous studies that are showing again and again that what's the greatest producer of crime? Inequality. And so more unequal societies produce more crime. And less unequal societies produce less crime, i.e. Norway. So certainly, and housing is probably the most glaring manifestation of how inequality works itself out. But I think housing and neighborhoods come into play the most, and again, thinking about Norway, because in the quote that I read, he said, well, do you want them to be your neighbor? But nowadays, our neighbors are just like us, because neighborhoods are so segregated. And so it becomes easier to kind of funnel those guys into that neighborhood or that halfway house or that, you know, over there, so that we don't have to deal with them. And then they're not our problem anymore. And so we don't have to even say, and actually I think it's a poor argument to say, we should care about this because they're going to come home to our neighborhoods, because that's still a selfish one. It's still saying, I'm just worried about my own safety. So, I mean, and there's nothing wrong with being worried about your own safety, but it should be about more than that, I think, because we are in this together, right? We live in this world together. We are a community, and, you know, it should certainly be about inclusiveness. So
did you examine that in terms of within your book, or is that something that
it's talked about in an ancillary way? I wouldn't say it's, you know, directly talked about. I'm most concerned with housing when it comes to housing is most directly talked about in the Singapore chapter, where I talk about reentry, because I go to a halfway house in Singapore and think about the problem of housing for people coming home.
It's definitely associated for recovery, even purposes. Going back to an old environment or encourages old habits, so it's very, yeah.
Definitely.
I think about Norway and their kind of open prison system, and I wonder, to what degree, since kind of those European countries have healthcare that you know is very robust, and so if you have mental issues, then you get help. If you have, there's a larger safety net, to where in the United States, where a lot of a number of the crimes are driven by mental illness, perhaps, or desperation for poverty, despair going into drugs. If, you know, pulling other things into that, to what degree Norway is getting away from that because they have a big social net, and if you could compare that to some of the other countries you visited.
Yeah, I'm glad. I mean, mental illness is the thing that I didn't bring up tonight, and it's certainly one of the great, you know, the great dark shadows of our criminal justice system. So certainly healthcare is tied into who's going to prison or not, and access to healthcare, access to drug treatment. In Singapore, one of the things that I encountered was that there's no rehab, there's prison. Or a halfway house, and so there's no real options. That's how deeply criminalized drugs are. Thailand is slightly better than that. And the same is true about healthcare. I mean, I think the most glaring example is the one you brought up, which is the U.S. We don't have access to all these kinds of services that could potentially keep people out of the criminal justice system. And then once you're impacted at all, then you're even further removed because you're not eligible for it. So we're creating this, you know, this horrible cycle of not giving the services to the people who need it the most. And the crisis of mentally ill people in prisons is, in Polesmoor in South Africa, there's one social worker for every 300-something people in prison. And, you know, what are you possibly going to do for somebody given that? And the numbers are not much better in other places. Uganda, and actually this is true about Polesmoor too, the TB infection rate in prisons is unbelievably high. So you have diseases going around that are even, you know, in some ways it's even a luxury to talk about mental health because people are dying of dysentery and TB in these systems. But it's all tied together. And I think Norway has something called the principle of normality, which is that when you go to prison, you still get the same healthcare from the community where you got it. You go to the same doctor. You remain part of the fabric of that community. And going to prison doesn't, you know, sever you from it. So in that way, that doesn't mean it doesn't make your life difficult, as, you know, as he said, but you're still connected to it. And I think that that's a principle that is applicable to other countries, whether you're as wealthy as Norway or not.
My question has to do with, there's been a lot of research with juveniles, with adolescents around brain development and treating this population a little bit differently. And I'm curious if there is any conversation around young adults, the 18 to 24-year-old. You talked about Wandu in Australia, and I was like, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So there is starting to be, actually, and there is, I know of people in the U.S. Who are looking specifically at that population, actually, as, I mean, juvenile is such an arbitrary term, right? We just decide, and in New York, actually many of my students in New York went to adult prison at 16, because we're one of two states, us and North Carolina, who will send a 16-year-old to an adult prison. And so we arbitrarily put these numbers, and this is true around the world, where juvenile is very arbitrary meaning, if anything at all. And so they'll kind of like approximate people's ages. If they got room for them here, they'll put them here. And so it doesn't, you know, it's, and I don't focus specifically, I did go to juvenile prison in South Africa specifically for those under 16. And you watch them sit there. I mean, one of the biggest crises, and I think this impacts juveniles in particular, is this crisis of remand. This is true, actually it's true in our country. I'm sure some of you are familiar with the case of Khalif Browder in New York, in Rikers Island, who spent 3 years there waiting for trial on accused of stealing a backpack, and ultimately came home and committed suicide. Obama mentioned him in the context of why he's abolishing solitary, right? So remand is impacting juveniles because of the particular vulnerability. But I will say there's a colleague of mine is doing a study on that age group in particular, Vinnie Schiraldi, who's formerly this advisor of criminal justice to the mayor in New York, who's now at Harvard and is writing specifically about that. So
thank you.
It's definitely a topic of interest.
Hi, thank you very much. I thought it was very inspiring to hear you speak, so thank you first and foremost. I just had a question about the recidivism rates across the different countries that you visited, and if you could speak on behalf of any of that.
Yeah, recidivism rates. They're pretty, so America's recidivism rate generally hovers around in the 60-something percent, 63%, a number that should make everyone, you know, ill. Because frankly, any system, I mean, if we had a company that was at a 60% failure, 63% failure rate, you'd overhaul it. But yet here we are tolerating such a thing, right? The numbers that I saw in the countries that I visited were not much better in most countries. Singapore has one of the lowest in the world. They've got like a 23% recidivism rate. Then again, they arrest people for, you know, eating durian fruit on the subway, literally. So, well, you're going to get fined. But, you know, and I think the global sort of problem of recidivism rates, Norway's, of course, expectedly is also pretty low in the 20s percent, too. But, you know, again, it's all evidence of the fact of why are we so sort of lazily relying upon this system if it's not giving us the results that we want, and it isn't giving any country the results that they want. I mean, recidivism in some ways is is the easiest thing to talk about because it's just so basic, you know, people going back. But it's also important to think about, well, what happens? Okay, somebody doesn't go to prison, but they're homeless, depressed, and, you know, lost. As far as I'm concerned, that's going back to prison. And yeah, I'm glad they're not committing crime and making communities unsafe, but people deserve the right to come home and live robust lives and not just not go back to prison. It's always the first question that I'm asked about my students in the prison to college pipeline, what's your recidivism rate? And you know, there's a lot more to success than just not going back to prison, right? But.
Hello, thanks once more for your talk. That was excellent. I'm not even sure what question I have. I feel like the need to ask something because it's such a vast, compelling. First off, did you visit any prison systems in the Middle East region?
I did not. I tried to get access to Saudi and came close and ultimately didn't.
Okay. Do you have a desire to?
Absolutely. I also wanted to go to Israel. I was very curious about there's some prisons that mix Arabs and Israelis and have some really interesting programming around that. But I mean, the world is big, and there were a lot of. I also didn't go to Russia, which I certainly would have loved to do. There's, you know, in no ways can the book be comprehensive. But the Middle East is something that I tried, but Saudi wasn't having me.
Sure. All right, and also it's maybe a general question, but when you talked about abolishing the prison system, and where does that leave the judicial system, or at least the people that are. That determine the fates of folks, whether it's the judge, whether it's the jury, whether it's the prosecutor, when you think about these inherent flaws or biases or ignorance that people possess, I mean, where do the supposed offenders, where do they stand in that whole process, the litigation process and whatnot? I mean, where does...
Yeah, so it's a big question, and it's and I take it on in the book, but I'll say that, I think that the trial system as it stands now is not necessarily, is not really healing to victims most of the time. It often further traumatizes them and is not necessarily so effective in terms of offenders. So in my vision of justice, our court system and our trial system would look very different and not be, you know, not consist of the kind of prosecutor defendant, where the individual who committed the act doesn't even have to speak necessarily, is relegated to the background, where the victim has no voice, the victim has no choice but to be there. Also, in many instances where he or she is not, and there is no sort of mechanism for creating a healing avenue for this victim. So really, I think we need to rethink the entire approach to trials and courtrooms and the very mechanical, factory-like way that we mete out justice and think about whose needs is it really meeting, ultimately. And it's a big question to say how that would look, but I do know that the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and the Gachacha and some of the models that have been established in that type of scenario, which didn't involve prosecutors and defenders, would be at the heart of it.
Okay. And sorry. Lastly, another kind of general question, privatized prisons again. It seems like it's just kind of just a growing, developing phenomenon in the last, just in the last decade. It's just getting bigger and bigger, and just like the food or education or healthcare industry where people stand to capitalize off people's misfortunes and hardships. How is this in the foreseeable future something that you go against, that you fight against, that you...
As it stands now, I guess that's one realm in which I am not an optimist. I mean, I'm scared of the Corrections Corporation of America, CCA, which is the largest private prison company in this country. Their power is frightening, and we need to, mobilize against that. It is appalling how much they are able to influence the law in this country, and those are the ways that are frightening. And this is true about many other countries around the world, in England, in Australia, that there is an enormous amount of power, and it's quite scary. So if I'm encouraging picket lines, it's certainly around, look up CCA, look up Serco, and some of these companies that are doing some things. On the other hand, as I was saying, I think that there are ways that privatization can allow for progressive pockets. And I also think when it comes to privatization, we need to think bigger than just the CCAs that I mentioned, the big billion-dollar companies, but also the ways, as you mentioned, like the little ways in which prisons are, making money, charging inordinate amounts of money. The system is starting to charge for, charge rent and lawyer fees and this, and you come home and you're in debt, and then you're stuck in this cycle of debt. So the whole, when we think about the prison industrial complex, it's more than just the evil, convenient devil of a massive private prison company, but rather the ways that we've allowed money to be so deeply embedded in our justice system. I was in a lot of places where bribery is rampant, and we like to look down, Uganda being the most glaring. I witnessed many acts of bribery almost every day, and we think of that as so corrupt, and yet basically we know here that justice is the lawyer you can buy. So isn't that a form of bribery? So we're allowing money to taint our system in all kinds of ways that are bigger than just private prisons.
All right, thank you very much.
Sure. She's the boss.
We just have time for one more question. I just want to say thank you so much for dealing with our very loud, sold-out event upstairs as well. So, but we have one more time or one more question, and okay. Afterwards, please join us for questions on the side too. So,
everyone kind of excited about the restorative justice thing. I just wanted to mention that there is a restorative justice movement that's happening right now in Seattle, that's being led by communities. They're most directly impacted, and it's nice. In the Rainier Valley area of Seattle, focused on juveniles. But along that realm,
great.
I'm.
What is the name of it?
No More Jim Crow. There's also Epic, right?
Those are two community groups that are a part of it. They have their own, their name. I'm not directly involved, so I don't want to speak for them or anything, but. Along that realm, I'm most used to discussing restorative justice from kind of like from an abolitionist framework. So that's as an alternative to incarceration. So I was curious how that works in some of the prisons,
mm-hmm.
if that's different, like where the overlaps are.
Yeah, it totally is. And in fact, in Rwanda, I was looking at restorative justice as an alternative to prison, because it was used, in the Gachacha courts, not with the young people I was working with, but in terms of the history of Rwanda. And There are different, restorative justice is this kind of umbrella term for a lot of different kinds of work. And some of it is using it in a prison context. In Polesmore, obviously, I was seeing it being used in a prison context. And I was most interested in it because I wanted to understand the mechanisms of how people can process, you know, emotionally what they've done, make amends to victims, and, you know, and engage with them emotionally. But to me, the most exciting restorative justice programs are the ones that are using restorative justice in lieu of incarceration, certainly. And the one I mentioned, Common Justice, they're in New York, so I know the most about them, and I think they're the most doing some of the most exciting work in this arena. But you know, restorative justice is more often used in a prison context, not in lieu of. There are many states that have it as part of their Department of Corrections, where you can reach out to victims through this particular unit, but how effective that is or how much that does is questionable. Okay. Thank you all.